And welcome back, everyone, to another episode of the Black and Blue Pod. This time, I am in COVID isolation because you gotta love 2021. But we're gonna keep our spirits high. We got another great interview here with my guest, Chris from National Vintage League. Now, if you're not aware, the National Vintage League specializes in old, but vintage, as the name says, vintage gear from your favorite teams, your favorite colleges, whatever. And he's going to be talking to us on behalf of his partner, Hugh Coles, who is apparently mighty, mighty up there in the acting world. So I respect him. I respect him and his hustle. But Chris, thank you for coming on the show. Really appreciate it, man. How you doing?
I'm good. And I appreciate coming from an American representing a British jersey store. It's a big thing. And I appreciate that you leaning over the pond, extending the olive branch in your hand and shouting us out. Because, I mean, I know that that's hard for you guys to accept that we're the GOATs.
It is very hard. I watch a couple of soccer games and I'm like, what is happening right now? There's no violence. There's not enough violence for my American brain.
But, right. You know what I mean? Yeah, exactly.
So let's just jump right into it. So first of all, how did National Vintage League like come about, and how did you join the company? Because you joined a year later, correct?
Yeah. So like Hugh started it around his kitchen table with basically the whole idea to stop people getting ripped off, because there's so many fakes out there at the moment. And also kind of like help the UK NFL community, have something. So like, community and authenticity, those were always the sort of the two tenets that we've always tried to hold on to. And then he like quickly became too popular to stay in his parents. So he moved out into the first of the rooms that we now have in our warehouse in Peckham. And it was just serendipity that, yeah, like you said, like, I think it was just less than a year later, I was looking for something. We met, we kind of hit it off. He was like, listen, I have all this other stuff going on. I was like, that's good, because I don't have any stuff going on. And that was it. Like, I was just like,
I'm pretty free. If you have any time, I'm pretty free.
Right. I was the lucky one. You know, I think there have been hundreds since. I'm like, damn, I wish that had just been me. But yeah, I was the lucky one that managed to come on board. And ever since then, we've been running the company together and, always tried to stick with those two original pillars of community and authenticity. And I think that's like what we still hopefully do even all this time later.
So those are definitely good traits to have. And I just want to get your opinion, like, just as a NFL fan in the UK, for me as an American NFL fan, you're born into it. Like, didn't, especially from where I'm from in the Philadelphia area, you're an Eagles fan pretty much from birth. What is it? Well, yeah. Oh, don't even get me started. Just look at past episodes to hear my opinion on the current state of the Eagles. So how did you get introduced to NFL and to the NFL, and how has your fandom kind of expanded since? And I don't know if you could speak for Cole on his behalf. I don't know if he's told you any stories about getting exposed to the NFL, but what has it been like to see the NFL just kind of come into the UK more and more over the past half decade?
Well, here's the thing. Like you said, like, you got born into it, as did most Americans. They get born into their fandom, and that if they choose to follow sports, you know, they don't really have a choice who they're really supporting most of the time. But in the UK, because like you said, it's not so much a recent thing, because obviously, you know, they did have games over here in like the mid-80s and stuff. And like, there has been a fan base there since then. But that's the thing. It's harder for us. You know, we've got to stay up later. You can't be a casual fan here. You've got to be a diehard, passionate fan, which makes the community great, because they're a passionate community. And, I think at this point it's like, you know, 18 million people in the UK watch the NFL a week, you know, when the season's on, which is, I mean, in America, that seems like a small amount, but over here, like, that's crazy to think how the game's grown in 30 years from nothing to that.
Yeah, exactly. That's incredible. No matter how much like growth, even for the NFL, that's still very impressive. Do you have any memories of like watching a specific team and you're like, that's my team? Or did it kind of just evolve over time?
Well, I can speak for Hugh. I know that he picked Tampa Bay because he was playing a computer game at the time. I think it was ESPN 2K5, and that's the one he picked. And I think they just won the Super Bowl, so he was like, "Yeah, I'll go with them." And then he was
yeah,
like,
"I'll go on them." Yeah.
And he was like, you know, had to sit through the doldrums of the next, you know, 20 years before
he was like, "Oh yeah, they're going to be winning Super Bowls for years now," and then they just go through this dormant 20 years.
So sort of joke was on him, but then the same kind of thing happened for me because I'm a Washington fan. So like I remember when I was very young, they used to put on the over in the UK, they put on used to put on the teams that were good. And that time it was in that era, it was the Dolphins and Washington, the Hogs and everything. So my dad used to watch it. And I remember as a very like, you know, as a 10-year-old coming and watching it. And then I moved to DC in 2010. And he said, like, I don't know if you remember, but we used to watch the, at the time, Redskins play. And if you get into American football, support your home team, support the team you're from. Don't like glory hunt. Don't like, he was like desperate for me not to become like a Cowboys fan or something, I think. And then the first best friend I made in DC, who I still am in a fantasy league with to this day, was a huge Washington fan as well. And so he was just like, got me into Washington, got me into fantasy, got me like really gave me the huge crash course in like a couple of years. And then before you know it, it's like, you know, it's hard not to love it when you start getting into it.
Yeah, definitely. And as an Eagles fan, your dad did you right, not trying to make you a Cowboys fan. He did everything.
Yeah, exactly.
He did the right things. Don't be Dallas fans.
Yeah,
yes, we can agree on that. Yeah. So just to get back to the business. So what it like vintage apparel, is so hard to kind of like grade, price, like whatever you want to say. Like what part of that era, was it just growing up, you were just really drawn into that era of fashion, or was it more of just compared to like as uniforms have evolved over time, you just loved the old designs more because it was more sentimental? Like I'm just trying to get a feel for what was the draw for that era?
I mean, Hugh obviously had the vision initially, and like I was a football fan and I liked vintage in general. You know, I liked thrift shopping and, you know, buying used rather than buying new. That was always something I did, but, you know, before we even met. And, you know, he loved the stories of it. You know, then you get into some of the old colorways, like the old Oilers, like Columbia Blue colorways.
Oh my God, the Oilers. You know, oh my God, the Oilers are perfection.
And then you start thinking about, well, there's the history there. Then there's a team that are defunct now. There's a whole story behind that. You know, you've got players that, you know, played on a defunct team that are still to this day, like legends of the game. And all of that can be encapsulated in a jersey, right? And so we do like a campaign on our reels on Instagram where we show the best plays of someone and show their jerseys. And the catchphrase is, it's more than just a jersey. Because that's what we feel, is that all these jerseys are stories of players in the NFL, whether they're from more recent or from back in the day. All of these players, even whether they were famous or not, or whether they did some niche crazy ass thing, and you're just like, oh yeah, I'm definitely getting a, you know, Chargers Doug Miller jersey because he was struck by lightning twice and it's got two lightning bolts on the shoulders. Why wouldn't you? No one knows him for any reason other than that. But like, yeah I'm gonna grab that because it's got a story attached to it. And like that's what we just try and well sell, I guess, but also to the fans and to the UK community, it helps teach people about the past of the game, you know, teach people about the history of the NFL, because it's so rich and so amazing. And I would argue like much more colorful than like the sterilized kind of version we've got today. But that's the best thing about jerseys and vintage stuff, is that they're all stories about the past. You know,
definitely. And there's so many incredible moments captivated in a jersey. Like when I see a Deion Sanders 90s Atlanta Falcons jersey, I can see him tiptoeing his way into the end zone after intercepting someone. And those type of moments are special. And for me, like the Eagles, Kelly Green, please, for the love of God, Jeffrey Lurie, you can mess up the team. But if you bring back the jersey, I will forgive you for everything. Yeah. I will watch this team go down to the toilet in style. That's how I'll watch this team.
Yeah, definitely, man. Like, but get the old Randall Cunningham throw out there, Reggie White. But here's, for example, like Eagles fans remember Jerome Brown. You know, most people remember Reggie White, but Jerome Brown is kind of like a more niche jersey for an Eagles fan to get. So you get Jerome Brown in Kelly Green. For an Eagles fan, that's like, well, that for me tells me more of a story, because it shows I understand this team better than just getting a Randall Cunningham jersey or a Reggie White jersey, for example. You know, and that's the level of nicheness that I love about every fan base. Every fan base has a player that they're like, oh, that guy was so dope, man. I wish I had his jersey. And then if you see it, you're like, oh man, I remember like my dad took me to a game where he ran a punt back or something. And there's always like this nostalgic memory attached to attached to events in your past to do with the sport. And like, you'll see a jersey and it'll just unlock it all. And you'll be like, oh man, I bloody remember the helmet catch, or I remember this or that, whatever.
You know, exactly. Exactly. So do you have any specific jerseys? Like, I don't know, growing up, like Washington, to me, they have one of the best color schemes, but it's executed very poorly, in my opinion. Like, do you agree? Like, or are there any specific jerseys? We talked about the Oilers a little bit. Are there any specific jerseys that you wish you could bring back if you were just Roger Goodell and could just change it?
Yeah, I mean, of course, Tampa Bay creamsicles, standard.
Yes. I mean, yes. I think people hate on the creamsicles. I don't get it.
No, you bring that back immediately this year. I think they have that option this year. So you bring back the creamsicles, or you change the logo to Bucko Brews this year, then you bring it back. You know, Tennessee, we were talking on the podcast to Kevin Dyson, right? Who obviously moved cities from one franchise to the other with the Oilers. And we were saying, what did you think when they unveiled that uniform and you saw you lost the powder blue? Like, that must have been like the worst moment, right? And it was like, no, we were just really happy. But looking back, yeah, the powder blue.
Yeah, looking back, we wish we could change that a little bit.
Yeah, again, if they bring that back, they could undo a lot of, you know, the Titans, for example, great team to bring it back at the moment because they're actually looking good for the first time in years. So it's like, imagine
first time
winning
since
the Steve Super
McNair
Bowl.
Was quarterback.
Right, winning the Super Bowl wearing the powder blue. Bro, it's got to happen.
You got to do it. I don't understand. Yeah. Like Denver's another team where I'm like,
yeah, get that orange crush back, baby.
The orange crush with the powder blue helmets, the Elway era. How do you not hate on that? I don't understand.
There's so many.
There are a lot. So you mentioned having Kevin Dyson on your podcast, the National Vintage League show. Has there been any other guests that you're so dumbfounded, you're like, how am I interviewing this person right now? Like, they should have much better things to do. They should have much, like, the way I'm talking with you right now, I feel the same way, where I'm like, this person must have much better things to do than talk to me right now about football jerseys.
that's very kind of you. I don't, and I'm always happy to talk about football jerseys with whoever's going to listen. But no, it does get to that point where, you know, every one of those guests is a legend in their own way and in their own right for things that they've done in the NFL or even before. I mean, we spoke to Caleb Farley, but anytime I'm doing that, I feel honored and dumbfounded that I can just talk to these people on a really human level, because that's what we try and do, is separate separate the player from the person, because all these guys often have to give such prescribed responses to all interview questions, and it's so boring and contrite, and you never really learn anything. And at the end of the day, we're English, so like, no American's going to listen to us for like hot takes on who to start in fantasy, because you know what I mean, we're not idiots, we know that, but at the same time, we're there to disarm a couple of players and get them to be themselves and get them to be a lot more upfront with us than they would maybe be with someone interviewing them in the States. So like, we can get away with playing Jacoby Jones fucking old Nokia ringtones in a game called Jacoby's Tones, and it's ridiculous. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, and that's the thing that I think we get as being British fans, is we kind of have that license to mess with people a little bit more, because it's like, you guys take the piss out of us all the time. Like, the amount of videos we'll post, and then Americans are like, you guys should stick to soccer, you're a disgrace. Like, okay, cool, I get that, I feel you, but like, you know, whatever, we have something we can bring to the table too, I guess.
No, definitely. And I think I've just having friends who are obviously NFL fans, it feels like there's always a competition with, you're not a real fan, you don't really know this player, you don't know the in-depth. Well, British fans, yeah, like you said, you have a license to fuck around and be like, why don't we make someone do something absolutely ridiculous that they wouldn't do with a US reporter? Like, that's just
because there's always someone that's gonna know more than you, always.
Yeah,
we're not
always
trying to ever claim with the fonts of all knowledge. We say working as every day is a school day, because literally I learn every day about stuff. You know, the amount of research I've done into random college numbers, like, oh, look at that, oh, look at that, that's that guy. Oh, great. Like, I didn't know that. I'm not gonna pretend I know that. But
yeah.
Like, it's all about learning about it. And like, if you're truly passionate about something, regardless of where you're from, you should want to share that. You know what I mean? You shouldn't gatekeep it. You shouldn't want to gatekeep knowledge or gatekeep enjoyment of it. You should be like, yeah, enjoy it. Do you know about this? Wow, that's amazing. I'm going to tell someone else and grow the game.
Exactly. Because that's what makes sports so fun, is that you can make fun. You can either make fun of a team, you can debate Jordan, Kobe, you can debate Cunningham or Vic, who's the more athletic quarterback? You can debate all those things. And to me, if you're just like, I'm not going to tell this person this data point that is like so niche, and it's like with 2 minutes left and three receivers on the field with 20 seconds on the play clock, like those type of stats, I'm like, why am I reading this stat right now?
You're sucking the fun out of this. Let's just talk.
This isn't math class. This isn't math class. Just give me the easy counting numbers: touchdowns, interceptions, passing yards. I can deal with that. Anything else, I'm just like, what is happening? What is happening right now?
This is why I love draft season, because it's like all these projections and predictions.
Oh my god,
no one knows anything. You know what I mean? Like, if the NFL draft and the history of the NFL has taught us anything, it's that you don't know anything. Scott Hansen said, you don't know anything. Like, you can make all the predictions you want and something will flip and you'd be like, okay, well, I look like a doofus now for trying to say that guy was going to be good. Oh yeah, Deshaun Watson, he's going to have a great career. People were saying that like last year, you know, like he's probably never going to play football again.
Yeah, we have no idea if he's going to step on the field. And then Trevor Lawrence, people are getting on Trevor Lawrence for saying that, yeah, I don't really have this chip on my shoulder. And people are all in an uproar. And I'm like,
right.
He's been anointed a savior of a team since he was 14, like taking the SATs. Like, why are we surprised about this?
But I mean, it's this, you could make the argument with most players. I mean, all of the elite athletes in the American school through college to pro draft system get conditioned at a very young age to be, oh, you're going to be great. So we're going to focus all of your, you know, talent on this thing because you could make it and you've got such a small chance, you know, versus the rest of the people, but you've got a chance and like, let's go for it. Like, no one gets this opportunity. But then things like lack of accountability come into it, like kind of like being the guy that always gets what he wants, you know, and that those skills don't translate very well into real life, you know? So as soon as you stop doing what people want you to do on the field and start making mistakes because you're young and you're immature and you've only been shown one way of life your whole life.
Yeah.
And it's natural and you're fucking human.
Yeah.
Like, you're like, you're the worst, you know? Yeah. You're the worst role model ever. It's like, I'm 19, man. Chill. You know?
Yeah. Like, I just went to class. Like, what did I just took algebra. Yeah. Like, what did I said something in algebra class is all of a sudden getting on the ESPN. It's like,
yeah,
let's relax here a little bit. And I compare that a lot with, well, for me as an American, just seeing all these young soccer players go into those academies at a young age. To me, that's just wild because it's the school designated where you can play soccer for like the rest of your life. What the fuck is that? Like, I don't get that. But coming from the other side on the pond, it's like, yeah, we have high school football teams that draw like 20,000 fans and then they're already getting like compensation. They're already like pretty much probably not even really taking real classes. Not saying everyone doesn't, but like, let's be honest, they're not taking calculus anytime soon, in my opinion. But I mean, that's just me.
I mean, through doing the what I do in the show, one of my good friends has become Roberto Aguayo, right? The kicker from FSU that got drafted really high by the Bucks and ended up sort of flaming out of the league. He's now making a comeback with the Patriots, right? And this guy is like mid-20s and he's already been a hero in the eyes of Florida State fans, a demon in the eyes of Buccaneers fans. Yes. You know, he's had it all. He got drafted, second highest kicker drafted since Mike Nugent, lost it all. And he's not even 30, you know? And it's like, bro, that's a crazy amount of life experience for one person to have to go through. And you went through it all with the national focus entirely on you.
Yes.
Of all football fans. Like, the pressure it's crazy to think people get put through this, you know?
Yeah, especially as kickers. Like, look at the Falcons kicker, Younghoe Koo. He got cut by the Chargers a couple of times, and now all of a sudden he went through this season a whole rebirth and was drilling kicks left and right for them, which was absolutely nuts.
Funny you mentioned the Chargers, because the Chargers also cut, but Roberto Aguayo was the last team he signed with before he made his comeback. And apparently he got told later that in the building they were saying, we should never have cut you. Because they made a choice, they tossed a coin because he went 9 for 9 in his preseason with them. He changed his kicking style by then, which was the reason that he was missing all the kicks with the Bucks, because he was kicking like a soccer player and he wanted to change his style and his swing like Tiger Woods, and eventually got there with the Chargers, because on Carolina he worked with Graham Gano and Graham Gano was helping him change his swing. And eventually he got good and they cut him and they said, we should have kept you. And the whole time you would have been the Chargers kicker. So now he's back with the Pats. Now Belichick, Belichick's playing chess, not checkers. Belichick's got Roberto Aguayo back in, nailing him. The best kicker in FSU history is now on the Patriots. Also, along with every other free agent.
Belichick's getting that draft report. He's like, who are we looking at? Roberto Aguayo?
Yeah, I know. The guy that's been a banker in Merrill Lynch for the past 2 years.
Why don't we sign him? We won't tell anything to the media. We'll just keep this all nice and shut. And yeah. We'll pump up on Instagram and maybe he'll do some trick shots for us.
Exactly. That's a good Belichick. I like it.
You got to just like, it's like a cat. Like a cat just like kind of like growls him, or like a dog just like growls. And then he like throws in syllables in between. He's a master. I'm convinced he does it on purpose. Like he just tight-lipped about everything. And then he'll give you some words to be like, oh, he said something. We just got to figure it out what it was. Yeah. Belichick's an absolute mastermind.
I bet he loves karaoke or something really weird that you'd never expect of him.
I would pay money to see Bill Belichick do karaoke. And yeah. I want to know what's his go-to song.
Exactly. He's got a satin jacket and a gold mic he keeps in a locker at the club. And he's just like...
Satin jacket, Elton John glasses.
Yeah, Crocodile Rock on a piano to nobody. Nobody.
He's hitting Benny and the Jets to like just an empty comedy club.
To the Jets. He's hired the Jets to come in and just make Belly and the Jets. Love it. That should be their band.
Bill Belichick just gets like Rex Ryan to play guitar.
Yeah, exactly. Tebow just there on piano.
Yeah. Oh my God. I want a whole NFL coaching staff band. That would be amazing. Just form the best NFL coach. Bill Parcells. I want to know Bill Parcells.
Do you ever watch any of the old, like, you know, back in the 80s, like when they were just putting teams together to do like Super Bowl Shuffle from the Bears?
Oh my God.
The Eagles did a terrible one. I don't know if you've seen that one. Like, they're just so embarrassing. Like, all of that.
It's like the 1980s too. Like it's such like a 1980s thing or 1990s thing. And I'm like, they really thought this was good. They thought this was good. It just hurts. But you can't, it's like a car accident. You can't help but keep watching it. I can't take my eyes off of it. So have you watched like ESPN like 30 for 30s, like the 85 Bears and some of those? Like, do you have any specific favorite like documentaries on a specific team or something like that?
Well, for me, my favorite documentary of all time is the Sean Taylor Football Life, because being a Washington fan, like, you know, I was introduced that he obviously existed before I came into the fandom orbit. But I think like, and it's one of obviously my biggest regrets that I never got to experience that time of him playing. But I've made it kind of my mission to learn as much about him and that time when, you know, we actually had players that you should be afraid of. So I've got his like jerseys, I've got both his jerseys, I've got his Pro Bowl jersey, which is obviously a real grail for me personally, you know, because that was the year, you know, the season he was killed, and that was the one that, you know, Chris Cooley and that were wearing in honor of him at the Pro Bowl. So for me it's that, definitely.
That hit where I don't even know who the punter was. But
Brian Moorman, baby. Brian Moorman. And Brian Moorman kept that jersey and it's framed because apparently it still has a little bit of yellow paint from Sean's helmet. God. Hit it onto his chest, yeah.
Like, amazing. Taylor was just one of those guys. You don't fuck with coming over the middle. You don't fuck with him. What am I going to do? What am I going to pop? No matter how big I am, I could be Calvin Johnson size. I'm going to get hit in the chest somewhere in the shoulder, probably dislocated. What am I going to do with coming across the middle against a guy like that?
Yeah, you eliminate it from the field of play. And so, you know, he was just such an amazing player. And he reminds me a lot of watching I know they play different positions, but watching some of the things that Chase Young was doing, like the Chase Young fumble recovery, scoop and score, that reminded me a lot of Sean's one in the playoffs. You know, like just being in the right place at the right time, having one of those players on your team that can just completely change it up, you know.
And it's so rare when it's on the defensive side of the ball too. Right. Everyone focuses
Reggie White, you know what I mean? He was a good example.
Brian Dawkins, I feel like, was one of those guys. Dawkins, he could definitely change the momentum of a game. As a football fan, do you think that, like, are you frustrated by sometimes the padding of rules for offense? Just, I know there's the whole issue of concussions and everything like that. But Ray Lewis, I think, went on ESPN a couple of months ago, and he was complaining about how defenses can't do anything. No matter what they do, they're going to get flagged. It feels like, as a fan, do you share that, a little bit of that perspective? I'm not saying ignoring concussions and everything like that.
Yeah, here's the thing. I mean, the science shows that football, the way that we all enjoyed watching it, wasn't good for anybody, which sucks.
Yeah.
And that's the bottom line, is that people liked big hits, and they like, you know, that's the reason you watch the game, you know, and the sad and the funny thing is, I knew someone who created a helmet, was this while I was living in the States, who had created a helmet that was proven to reduce concussions by 60%. And the way that they did it is they put a tiny bit of foam around the outside instead of the hard plastic. Yeah. And so if you put a bit of foam around, like, you know, that sort of thin foam, you know, like that kind of around the helmet, right? Mm-hmm. You still have like the colors on it and stuff, but it's not going to be shiny and it's not going to be hard. And they pitched it to the NFL. Doesn't have the sound.
Yeah.
The NFL said, we're not going to put this because people want to hear the crack of the helmet, which is the worst thing. You know what I mean? But they're right. And they do.
Yeah,
and
they
that's
are.
The paradox is that, you know, people want to see that. Like I was talking to Tommy Harris, right? The Bears defensive tackle, destructive player on the interior for that Bears defense in sort of, you know, the mid 2000s when they had the Super Bowl run. And
back with Jay Cutler.
Sadly, yeah. He was talking
and Rex
about
Grossman
that.
Started.
He was saying, like, man, when Jay came, he goes, I didn't even sit down all year. I said, this guy's gonna have a straight back out there.
His defensive player just like, shit, we're not even gonna get a rest.
Right. So, when Jeff Garcia, the quarterback, was playing at the Lions, there was a hit that Tommy Harris put on Jeff Garcia. And we had Jeff Garcia on the podcast, and we played a game with him called Jeff Garcia's Grassy Ass, where we showed him footage of him getting sacked, and he had to say who the person was that was sacking him, right? And like some of these hits were so brutal, it was crazy that he could remember. And one of the brutal ones was the Tommy Harris hit, because his head snapped right back, right? And the NFL took the video down. And so when I didn't know this, and we put it on the show, and you can still see it on the show. The Jeff Garcia episode. But and then when I spoke to Tommy Harris, I was like, oh, funny, your name came up when we were interviewing Jeff Garcia. And I didn't know they'd taken the clip down. He goes, have you got that clip? I was like, yeah. He goes, because the NFL took it down. I told my son how hard I hit this guy, and he doesn't believe me. I was like, well, yeah, I got it. But like, yeah,
I'll believe
brutal,
you.
But it's brutal. You know what I mean? And yeah, I mean, what can you say?
I mean,
you have to make a lot of allowances to watch NFL morally. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Because, you know, like, let's talk about Mike Vick. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah,
I love Mike Vick. I love what he did for the game. But if you can't separate the fact that, you know, he went to prison for, you know, funding a dogfighting ring, then morally it puts you in a difficult position. It's like, how can I enjoy the demon that he was on the field, but also reconcile that? How can I cheer for Tyreek Hill knowing what he did to his son? How can I, you know, enjoy this game knowing there are concussions? There's questions you could ask yourself at any point of the game. And so I feel like it's better just to be like, what am I okay with? You know, let's not like get like moralistic or virtue signal about the whole game or about this or that, or, you know, why is it okay that people that punch, you know, guys, it's fine, but when it's women, it's terrible. You know, where do we draw the line? And I think that's always up to you as an individual where you draw the line. And I can understand why people don't watch the NFL because of all those difficult decisions that like you get thrown at.
I agree. I understand why people may choose not to watch the NFL. For me specifically, just specifically talking about the concussion part of it, I think that there's a point where you can only reduce the concussion so much, and then it's just the nature of the game, and that to me is where it kind of gets like, how much are we really going to affect the way the game is played before it's not even football anymore, and it's prioritizing the concussion so much that players can't even really hit like they used to. And I'm not saying that like you got to take someone's head off, but when it feels like the targeting penalties specifically, especially in college, in my opinion, that's where they do a terrible job of administering the targeting penalty, because sometimes a player is just sliding and a defender is already going in for the hit, shoulder first maybe, and the head just naturally goes down and they still get ejected. And that's where I'm really frustrated as a fan.
Here's the thing. I think that the people that are making these rules and saying these things really haven't played the game and don't know how fast the game is and how quickly decisions have to be made and how little time these players have to even get to the player, let alone adjust their head in the right way so that they're not targeting or trying to avoid injury themselves. Because, you know, you're putting your body on the line too. It's not like you're trying to hurt someone else just as much as you're trying not to get hurt as well. You know, like,
So
I think that it's easy to sit there and go, oh, well, they need to do this, they should do that. But I think the reality is, and unless you've played the game and you can understand how difficult it actually is to implement the kind of things that they want you to do whilst you're also computing where a route's going to be run, how deep it's going to be, is that going to be a fake? Oh, and I've also got to make sure I don't hit this guy there or there with that or that part of my body. Come on, man. So hard enough.
Yeah, exactly. I'm just thinking about a linebacker's perspective. A guy like Mike Singletary on the 85 Bears, you're going to ask
Samurai Mike.
Of course. And you're going to ask him, hey, read this coverage, make a call your defensive play, and then possibly make an audible, and then read whatever receiver's running, whichever route, like you said. And then, oh yeah, let me not use my head, which is how I get paychecks, is tackling guys. Like, that's, at what point are we just diluting the game?
And it's a blitz. Oh, but make sure I don't land on the quarterback.
Yeah.
Make sure I don't actually hit him too hard. You know,
the roughing the passer penalties drive me nuts. Even when they go like for the Eagles' favor, I'm like, Jalen Hurts gets farted on, and then that's a roughing the passer penalty. And it's like, what? How? I'd rather almost not a penalty not be called and the Eagles actually score a touchdown the right way, if they could even score a touchdown. God knows how the fuck this offense is going to be this year.
I know, but you guys really shanked that one over the last couple of years.
Did you do you subscribe to The Athletic by any chance?
No, I don't.
There was this whole bomb.
I don't subscribe to anything. I'm like, no, I can find it mirrored on Reddit somewhere. I don't know.
I'm sure it's on Reddit. I'm sure it is. But there was a whole bombshell report again about how Lurie and Roseman would sit down Doug Peterson every week for 4 years, however long he was with the Eagles, and dissect like every decision that he made. And would
I did see about that, yeah.
Yeah, and
like, he was micromanaged and like
treated like a baby. And yeah. I just don't understand how these type of people get in power. And I'm just dumbfounded. When it feels like I could run the Eagles better than Howie Roseman, that's where it's a problem. So last thing I wanted to talk to you about was your native game, soccer, just as an American. What is your favorite kit? I've been told the proper term. What is your favorite kit just in soccer? It may not have to be in the UK, but in soccer, what's one kit that you're like, man, I wish I could rock that?
Easy. The old Arsenal Dirty Banana JVC. Mwah. So I didn't realize how expensive that jersey was or how sought after it was, because it's kind of like, it's weird because like jerseys, obviously they're only important to people that care about the sport and the jersey. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? To like most other people, it's just a piece of clothing. But like, if you understand about things, it adds value to it and blah, blah, blah. So yeah, those jerseys, obviously I don't really care about football, soccer very much at all. And my friend turned up in one of those, but I did know about that jersey. And I was just like, you know how much that jersey's worth? And he was just like, no. It's like, okay, you might want to look into that, bro, because that's like the fifth most valuable jersey in the UK. But yeah, I think that's cool because it's so ugly. It's so ugly that it's cool. And I love that everyone stuff that's wants so it. Ugly that it's cool, yeah. That's why I love NASCAR stuff.
Oh.
I know, I it's so ugly, but it's cool. It's so like neon cars and stuff. Oh, I love it.
Some of the soccer, like, I don't know if you follow Major League Soccer, probably not because it's trash, but
funny enough, Wayne Rooney turned up at DC United the week I left DC and went to my local bar where I would have been the week after I left DC. And I saw it. My friend filmed the Twitter video that ended up going on the stories about it because he was in the bar that we would have been in at my local bar in DC.
You're just like, God damn it. Really? The 1 week I leave
there for 8 years. And then the 1 week.
This guy decides to walk in here the 1 week I leave. Exactly. But like this Seattle team at the Seattle Sounders, like they have Xbox on their front in their jersey. So I'm like, you're the Seattle Xboxes. Like, how is this supposed to work that you just have no team name on them? And I'm just the advertisements on certain jerseys. We need to dial it back a little bit, in my opinion. Yeah. But
here's the thing: you can never tell, because what people think is horrible at the time will end up becoming super niche. So for perfect example is we found a New York Islanders starter quarter zip the other day, the old logo, the fisherman logo that they had for 2 years.
That everyone
had
hated.
To change because everyone hated it so much, right? But now everyone wants that one. You know what I mean?
Because it's people so know weird. Like everyone hates it. So why I got to get it?
Yeah. And it becomes like niche and like collectible and like, oh yeah. I need that. I need the Aaron Hernandez jersey because there aren't any anymore, you know?
If anyone has the balls to wear an Aaron Hernandez jersey at this point in their lives, respect.
Bro, we found a collector. He's asked us, we found him two of the three colorways, and he pays over the odds to complete his murder collection. Very strange. But hey, whatever.
That is...
Different folks, different strokes. I'm fine.
Yeah, I can't even argue with that. That is... Respect to him for at least sticking to something. He's stuck to a niche. That respect to there. So do you follow these storylines with Cleveland Indians, like the Native American names?
Right.
The Cleveland Indians, yeah, the Washington Redskins, the hat that you're wearing, obviously. Mm-hmm. Chicago Blackhawks and hockey. Mm-hmm. Do you have like an opinion? Like, is it a case by case basis for you? Like, I don't want to put you in a bad spot here, but like I just want to get your thoughts on that.
I'm not in a bad spot at all. I'm not the American white man that wiped out Native Americans over the course of the previous.
Well, look at me either. My family was cooking pasta in Italy for all I know.
My
I was
hands
not
are
doing
clean for that country's demographic in particular. We slaughtered a lot of you. And every other country in the world, but Native Americans, we did leave alone. I will
the
say
one,
that.
The one cake we didn't touch, we didn't eat.
Yeah, exactly. We didn't go anywhere near it. Well, here's the thing, right? I think it's great that all these names are getting brought into question because it's bringing into people's consciousness the idea of things that probably are problematic and people probably didn't realize they were problematic. And, you know, again, it creates you asking questions. Well, what do I feel about that? You know, and everyone's going to have their own answer about it. Personally, I think, you know, as a Washington fan, I can say for sure that our previous name was worse than a lot of them. But who am I to say where you draw the line?
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? Indians is just as bad, do you know? But then where do you want to go with it? So, you know, does Seminoles honor it? You know what I mean? Does Blackhawks honor it? I don't know, because probably not. Probably because it was a pretty cool logo and it sounds scary. You know what I mean? Like, I don't think it's got anything to do with honoring Native Americans at all. Like,
that's the thing. I'm thinking like back to like when these teams were founded, like the Blackhawks in like the 1920s or 30s or whatever. And I'm like, they probably weren't thinking this deep into it. They're like Chicago Blackhawks, got a nice ring to it.
I would even argue that if anyone was in any position of power and suggested honoring Native Americans in the 20s, they probably would have been hung. You know? So like, do you know what I mean? Like, let's not get it twisted. But here's the thing for me as a Washington fan, and even if we change the name, which I don't think we should do, I actually think Washington Football Team is dope. Give us the stripes back on the helmet, yeah, but leave the numbers. But even if they change it, for me as a jersey head and a jersey fanatic, that jersey is going to be so rare in 20, 30, 40 years.
A Taylor Heinicke Washington football jersey?
Mate, or even rookie Chase Young, and they would have made them. So, like, you know what I mean? Like, there's going to be lots of them around, but for a collector, that's going to be really niche because that's marked the change. It's almost like Tennessee Oilers kind of thing. It's like, well, that happened in a moment in time between a team changing from one thing to a different thing. Mm. And I'd love to get a, you know, throwback.
Have you seen the new not these weren't like finalists, but these are the type of names that Washington
I don't want to talk about it. I have seen them and I don't want you to mention any of them, and I don't want you to ask me which I prefer because I don't like any of them. That's they're all awful.
You don't like the Wild Hogs?
But that was a stupid motorbike film with like William H. Macy. That's all it's going to be. It's like a picture of like Chase Young and Ryan Fitzpatrick sitting on
Chase. They'll do the Islanders fisherman, but instead Chase Young on a motorcycle as the logo.
No, I just hope we keep it. I really do. But here's the problem. As long as Dan Snyder is still in charge, the same problem you've got, like we can only do so much. Doesn't matter how many initiatives you start, doesn't matter how many positive hirings you make, doesn't matter how much culture you want to bring in. While that guy is there, you're only going to get it's cursed. Ryan Fitzpatrick is going to break his leg on FedEx Field, as did all the other cursed quarterbacks before him, because Dan Snyder's still in charge. So the second he gets out, the second that the clouds will part and we can have some sort of a new future, as a new
A ray of
team, you know what I
sunshine
mean?
just comes down on FedEx Field and
Exactly.
just blesses Chase Young with like superhuman powers as if he doesn't have them already. I'm convinced he's an alien. If the
He is.
aliens came, I'd be like, oh, so Chase Young was here. You guys already came.
He's Predator. Body of Predator, face of Shrek. Love it.
So last thing, as a native of Britain, what is the one thing that Americans like associate with Britain that you absolutely hate?
Oh man, there's so many misconceptions about Britain. Because here's the funny thing, my wife is American, she now lives here, and she loves so many things about the UK, but you know, you guys don't care about us, so you're not gonna learn about us, you know what I mean? And I was just and I what I was saying to her was like, I was like, isn't it funny how America made everyone need braces? You know what I mean? In the 80s and 90s, if you didn't have braces, and now, and if you've got bad teeth, you're not taken seriously. Everyone thinks you're some sort of a yokel. I was like, in no other country in the world do people care about your teeth as much as Americans care about our teeth. You
Yes.
know what I mean?
Not even
And it's
our own
like,
teeth. We're caring
and
about other people's teeth.
we're not the ones paying 5 grand for fucking braces we don't need when we don't have insurance. Okay, have fun with that. You know what I mean? Like that for me, I was laughing about that the other day. That's funny.
You get the old classic, like the hello governess, like
Oh
all
yeah, love it.
those sayings.
It's either
I
that,
have.
or is that, or it's like the bad guy in like Wild Wild West. You know, he's like, "Oh, hello, I'm the British bad guy, Mr. Bond." You
It's
know.
always the classic Bond villain that's just
Yeah.
like super uptight and puts too much on it. Although I will say, I have incorporated bruv into my regular vocabulary pretty much
Love
into
it.
my text.
Love it.
I feel like a native already.
I introduced standard when I was out there. I was just like, yeah, standard, standard, standard. And then before you know it, they're going, standard, I like that. Yeah, it's just like standard, yeah. And then before you know it, there's this whole group of people in DC saying standard. It was great.
Cheers is a popular one with my friend.
Yeah.
He says cheers a lot, which is
Yeah.
we just
Cheers is
call him
good.
like our little British boy. Like we just
No
like
one
he's
says cheerio though. Please just, can you spread that? No one says
I will try my best to not to stop cheerio.
that. Yeah. F.A. Obada was saying that when he sacked, like he goes, I would go, we were saying, like, does it annoy you like being British in a locker full of Americans? He's like, you know, yeah, to be honest. But like he goes, but the only thing that really annoyed me is when he got a sack and the commentator goes, oh, cheerio. It's like, how diminutive. The guy's had to work against all odds to get to that position. He's British, he's sacking one of your American quarterbacks. He didn't go to school in America, and then it's like, oh, cheerio, British boy got a sack.
His only, like one of his only sags of his career, and he's like, that was attached with cheerio. I would, as a broadcast, someone who's done
Mean one
broadcasting.
of the only sacks of his year? 5.5 sacks last year. It's like Tom Brady, Aaron Rodgers, Drew
Whew.
Brees. Nick
Never
got one
mind.
hand on Mahomes and now just got signed by Buffalo. So that's
Whew.
all right.
Never mind. I
I've got
take
to
that
respect
back.
my boys. Got to respect the boys.
I don't want no smoke. I don't want no smoke. They could probably ball me up like a basketball and use my head as a baseball. I don't want no smoke with no linebackers or anyone in the NFL. They'll just smoke me.
But nice to bring in other sports, because that's the thing we branched into this year was all the other sports, because we're all football fans at heart. But I mean, you know,
So
Hugh
was there
Willie.
was that coming from fans, or did that just happen organically?
Yeah, that was one of two reasons. One was fans going like, do you have any basketball or baseball? And we were like, sorry, we don't, which basically just lets them go to other people. It's like, well, that's annoying, because we have access to all that stuff just as much as we have the NFL stuff, but we were well passionate about NFL, so that was the focus. But now it's like, well, you know, we'll just get the other stuff too. You know, starter jacket is a starter jacket, a sick teal Charlotte Hornets colorway or Detroit Pistons colorway is just as cool as a Miami Dolphins, you know, or whatever. So We started doing that, you know, hockey, basketball, baseball, NASCAR. So now it's like a one-stop shop for all of your American vintage sports, college, all your American vintage sports. And the funny thing is we're based in Peckham, London. So it's hilarious that we literally sell sand to the Egyptians when we sell back to America. It's like, oh, this is going back to Buffalo. There you go. Back to your home. Starter jacket. From London, yeah, go. Exactly. It's hilarious.
They're probably like, where did this pop up? And there was like probably someone right down the block from them that found it in like their attic.
Bro, two things. I'll tell you two stories before we finish about finding absolutely random grails. First of all, we were going through a random vintage bin up in the north of England. It's a gray day. And we come across Mike Davis, as in former Carolina Panthers, now yes. Atlanta Falcons running backs, All-American game-worn high school jersey.
How the fuck? How?
You know what I mean? Like, how? How does it get there?
Yeah.
Mud on it, right? And so that's like, that's jokes because we like reached out to him. We're like, we found your jersey in like
a box.
Yeah, do you want it? Yeah, and we sent it back to him. So he was like, that was dope. And then the other one was a random charity shop in like a tiny village in England, right? So not even like a wholesaler, like alongside like doilies and candles and teapots and you know Princess Diana mugs. You had a game-worn Dan Hampton, the Danimal, from the 1986 Bears Wilson jersey, just there in the thing. I was like,
what the fuck?
£15. I was like, yes, we will have that, and it will go on the wall, and there it shall stay. You know what I mean?
So do you want 15 or 15,000? Yeah. Because I don't think you guys know what you have here.
Right, yeah. Well, what we would do is go, do you want 15? I'll give you 5. Still going to make
ruthless Have you had any like memorable negotiations that just went either down south or just like went completely unexpected?
Yeah, definitely. Like we love American Pickers, you know, that show where the guys, yes. and also porn stars. So like the bargaining techniques on porn stars, like love it. Like
calling an expert.
Yeah, happy to walk away. You know what I mean? It's like, I can't do that. You know, I could do that. I'm just going to say I can't do that. But then there's sometimes that's great is because we got to the point now where we're not desperate. So we can be like, that's too much. I've got to work on margins for a business. Walk away. But often people reach out to us with stuff because they're like, you guys would enjoy it. Or like, I want it to go to a new home or something like that. So this one was, this guy called us and goes, I've been collecting dead stock in the bag NFL clothes since the 1990s, and I want to get rid of it all.
You just dropped the phone right there, just heart attack, just like, how the fuck?
Well, no, first of all, I was like, yeah, whatever, mate. And I was like, as always, like, send pics.
You know? That's always a great
Pixar. It didn't happen, you know what I mean?
No, and people believe them. I'm like, I was thinking to myself because I'm into like shoes, and I'm always constantly browsing like shoes on apps or whatever. I'm thinking to myself, people could just pull pictures from the internet, and I would probably believe them, and I would just go about it and totally believe them.
I mean, there are some horrible scam artists out there. And so that we always do that as well. We legit check anything. Anyone's buying from anywhere else, they can send us a screenshot of it before they buy. And then we'll tell them if it's authentic or not. Because, I mean, it's important to us. Some people don't care. They just like the colors. They don't care if it's fake. And that's fine. Each to their own, whatever floats your boat. But if you want to or need an authentication check, we do that for free. So, like, even if we're selling the item, like, people can hit us up and let us know, and we'll tell you if it's legit or fake.
Wow. So what happened with that bin from the 1990s with all that stuff? Did you guys ever?
Yeah, man. So it turns the pictures. It's all just perfect, like Campri jackets. LA, this is early 90s, so Los Angeles Raiders, like spell out bombers, you know, just stuff that doesn't exist anymore, but unworn, like out in the plastic, tags on. And he just sent it through, and it was all that. And he had like the hats, had shorts, had, you know, jackets, all different sports as well. You know, some of the coaches' jackets, like the half goose down, half feather ones. And this is back when there was no monopoly on merchandising. So like Reebok originally got the monopoly, and then it was Nike, and it's Nike now. But before that, obviously, every company like Champion, Starter, Logo Athletic, Campri, they could all produce their own versions of something if they got the licensing. And remember, they were in competition, so they were trying to make it the best of their abilities because they want to win the market, which means that it all lasts because it was so well made. So it all it's fine today. But you look at some of the more modern Nike jerseys, some of them might start peeling quite quick and everything like that. They don't make them like how well they used to make them. So
because they have no incentive to keep producing the best quality product. They know they're just going to win.
They want new fans to buy the newest jerseys every year. It's fine. And I mean, Nike just did a very, very shrewd move with sneakers where they started offering people to send back their old sneakers to get refurbished and give them a discount on new sneakers, which is said will be a $1 billion industry in, you know, in a few years. And that's the industry that we're trying to get the other companies to do. It's like, we had an argument with Carl Banks, right? CEO of Starter, ex New York Giants player, because we were like, you don't make any efforts to be sustainable at Starter. What you do is produce shitty new Starter jackets that aren't as good as they used to be. They look crap, and you're not making any effort to not use virgin plastics. And we got into like an argument with him on Twitter. But it would be so easy for any company like that to just, like Nike did, say, this is what we're going to do. We're going to let you send us back your old stuff, and we'll give you money off your next purchase, and we're going to refurbish it or send it to a country that needs it or something. They don't do any of that, you know? Yeah. And the vintage industry, like, people are smart now. Like, kids don't want new stuff as much as they used to, you know, unless it's Jordans. But a lot of the time, kids want to buy older stuff now and want to buy stuff that's like from the 90s or from the 80s or, you know,
like, there's a reason why Jordan still gets like billions of dollars in Jordan royalties from the ones. Like, the Jordan ones are like timeless shoe. And I agree, like, the vintage industry, I hope, takes off more. And I hope that brings more incentive for other companies to be like, listen, let's get the licensing. Let's just get something instead of just handing it over to Nike. Let them produce some shitty t-shirts that'll be like, I've bought Nike before, and they're great in the short term, but in the long term, they don't last. And
they also, the NFL also did a recent deal with H&M, the fast fashion clothing company in the UK, to produce, you know, like that stuff, like pretty cheap versions, you know, just to try and sell it as fast fashion.
Mm-hmm.
But there's no end game there.
Yeah.
You know, it's not a sustainable end game. All you're trying to do is capitalize on interest and make money, but the reality is, like, we all need to be more sustainable. Every business should have sustainability as one of its number one priorities at the moment, whether it's a small business like ours or something like Nike, you know. And if they all did it, it would, like, fast fashion is like the second or third biggest polluting, like, industry in the world, you know. And if we can't just be buying new crap shit all the time.
Yeah. And that's not, I don't want a, like, a jacket or a sweatshirt that's just going to get beat up and then the logo starts peeling off or whatever. And that's why I love interviewing companies such as you guys who value, like, preserving this history. I've interviewed why am I blanking on his name, Jeff Cohen, who does Ebbets Field flannels. He specializes in, like, made to wear made to order Negro League jerseys. They do soccer jerseys, they do football jackets, but it's like, it's quality because it's made to order. It's very expensive, but it's made to order, and it's handmade, and they go through all the designs, and it's authentic to the letters. And to me, as a sports fan, that's what I don't like seeing today, is just, yeah, let's just throw a label on it or throw a logo on a t-shirt or whatever. Like, and I think hopefully that brings back some of the 80s. We already got short shorts coming back. We might as well bring back some of the 80s, like, logos and everything like that, in my opinion. Yeah, but that's just definitely. Me.
I could just be
a fan yelling at the sky. Like, I just,
that's all we all are, man. That's all we all are. Like,
hopefully not. Hopefully that'll bring some change one day. Well, thank you for joining. Thank you for coming on the show. Hopefully we can have you back on soon at some point.
Maybe we'll get you back on hopefully one day. You know.
He's got two big Hollywood chops now.
Yeah, he's too big. He's too big now. Yeah. I barely get time with him. You know what I mean? He's the director of the thing.
You guys are at a business meeting. It's like therapy. Honestly, it's like I don't even get to spend a day with him. He doesn't even give me his full attention.
I was telling him it was easier for me to book NFL stars than it was to book him.
I could get Scott Hansen on here any day of the week, but you just don't even care.
Good old Scotty.
Well, hopefully he can come on. Thank you again for joining.